of those, there was a result of 84 fatalities. So we always like to spread the word when we have somebody who can actually talk directly to the topic, and so we're really pleased that we can do that today. I should turn off my phone. You guys are landing on top of mountaintop. He's going all the way to the moon. And so the last little story I want to relate to was just after Oshkosh last year, I was watching the low and slow. And on a Sunday afternoon, Trent came on and talked about wanting to talk about safety a little bit more. And that following Monday, I called him up and I said, if you really want to talk about safety, let's do it at Oshkosh. And they both agreed. And so that's how this whole thing got started. And with that, I'm going to leave it up to Charlie to keep it going, and we'll tell you the story. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, first off, I want to say thank you for attending the place is full. And the focus that we put on loss of control is because we want to keep our friends alive. And I want to just basically kick this off with a couple of thoughts. I'm going to hand it off to Trent Palmer, who can introduce his friend Nick. I can't tell you how courageous it is for Nick to come here and share his story, because every one of us who flies has a close call. And often when we do something that we wish we hadn't, we're reluctant to share because we feel that it is something we shouldn't have had happen to us, or we should have been able to prevent, and we're a little embarrassed by it, or we think that others wouldn't suffer the same problem, and therefore we're just a little bit reluctant to share. And I can tell you that in the world of safety, there's nothing more important than being able to feel like you're in a culture where it is accepted and enjoyed that people would share their lessons. And it does take courage, and it takes courage to create a culture where that's commonplace, accepted, and thanked. And so huge thanks to you both, Trent and Nick, for coming here today and sharing your lessons. Because frankly, the only way we can prevent others from having the same issue is if we do in fact share the details of how we got into the position we got into and how we can avoid getting there again. Can't thank you enough for doing that. So Trent, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Charlie. So I don't know how many of you guys watched the video I did as a follow-up to Nick's accident, but I said it pretty clearly that this is a nightmare. It's one of those things that we all know is a possibility, but it kind of feels like it's not going to happen to me. And it won't happen to one of my friends. And that day was pretty harsh reminder that it can happen to any of us, and I'm glad Nick's still here, and I'm glad he's willing to share it, so hopefully we can get other people to recognize the vulnerability that we all have. So, Nick?
Well, it was a beautiful morning, and Clint and I met up out of the lake bed, and we each have a passenger with us. I have my dad, and Trent had a buddy, Matt, and we're going out there to show a comparison video of the 912 versus the 915 that they just put into the plane. And flight was very uneventful, no issues whatsoever. Trent had landed, cameras were away, I wasn't comfortable landing where I was set up, and I went to make a square pattern, just standard pattern, and the moment I pulled up, I didn't realize I was in skid, and I was already losing airspeed, and by the time I looked around to my left to get a reference to the ground, the wing snapped on me, and it almost went into a spin, and I just went right back to my training pair. I pulled power, bronze level, rudder opposite, and elevator nose down to get some airspeed back. By the time I did that, I was about 270 degrees the other direction, and the ground met me. So it was a really surreal thing to be awake the whole time, going, knowing you're just not the mercy of the plane at that point. And yeah, it was the most incredible force ever. And I remember the plane settling down. I passed out momentarily, maybe it was 15, 20 seconds. My dad had run over, he woke me up. And I looked at him and I said, what happened? And they said, you crashed your airplane. And I looked at him and I said, is this real? It just felt like the worst dream ever. And I wasn't waking up from it. So, kind of got my bearings about me. He started talking to me. Everything was okay. My face was completely open. I was bleeding everywhere. It was just a real ugly sight. And that's the second I looked down at my legs and I saw what had happened. And my first instinct was, you know, feel. What can I feel? What have I lost? What's going on? Let's assess. I didn't feel a single thing. My whole body was numb. And it was just a very odd sensation. And then they kept me calm. They all went to work on keeping me secure, taping my face up, and working on getting me out of the aircraft. Trent was up within seconds after the accident. And he was on the phone with one of our dispatch buddies. And he also had a spot locator out, and he had Careflight on the way instantly. And sat there for about 30 minutes waiting for Careflight. And by the time they got there, they came out and put me into an IV. And about 45 minutes into it, I started feeling things. I said, all right, guys, knock me out. I don't want to be here for the rest of this. So got me out, and about 3 hours later, I was finally extricated from it. And I woke up the next day in the hospital with a breathing tube in and external fixators in my legs. I didn't even realize my right wrist was dislocated the whole time while I was sitting there. I just didn't feel a thing. And all I was focused on was my legs. But I sustained two compound fractures on each leg. Five broken ribs, dislocated wrist, shattered thumb, broken eye socket, lacerations to the face, a bruised lung, and that is the extent of it. Oh, I have that time. We found out a month later. Forgot about that one. But yeah, it's been a really, really crazy experience, and you know, that kind of brings me to the point of, you know, I was getting a little complacent. I was, you know, we were out there, we were just enjoying our time, and you don't think about safety all the time. And I'm just sitting there flying along and enjoying myself, and it bit me. It was instant. There was no hesitation. So it's just one of those things that it's always got to be in the back of your mind. Just because we're going low and slow doesn't mean it's any less dangerous than any other type of flying we all do. So it just makes you stop and think about what you're doing and what you want to accomplish and what your goals are. If it's worth doing what we do, or if it's worth landing there, if it's worth going to that hill. Granted, we were on a dry lake bed. It was all my fault. But it does make you think a lot more.
And really quickly, I mean, you weren't exactly a novice pilot. Nick's been flying for a little bit. He's got ratings, so it's not like it was your standard low hour private pilot. I mean, you're in the stock too about proficiency
Right, so I had finished the airplane about 2.5 months prior to the accident. I had about 150 hours on it, and during the phase one flyoff, all I did was go out there, I went up to altitude, stalled the aircraft, tried to burn the plane as much as I possibly could, because I wanted to know what it was going to do, when it was going to do it, and exactly what moment. So it was just, I knew the aircraft, obviously not me, and it was, I had well over 1,000 landings on it in 150 hours, and I still knew my limits with the plane. I didn't like to push myself. There was quite a few times trying to go and he was comfortable landing places and it just wasn't worth it for me. We didn't go there. So it's just, you don't want to be out there doing what you're not capable of and what you're not proficient at. So, but I knew the plane. And it was just a momentary lapse of not paying attention to what I need to be looking at, and it bit me.
And that's I think the big thing here is it's just the momentary lapse was really all it was. And that's the thing that I think most of the time probably gets, you know, with my videos, a lot of times I don't show any of the safety side of things, so a lot of times I think it's assumed that it's not there. But we do safety brief before every bit of formation or even any time a camera's out, we're gonna be filming operations. There's a safety brief beforehand and normally some sort of debrief afterwards with looking at footage and all of that. And those are the things that we should showcase more, but even that being there, the momentary lapse of judgment, the being caught in the moment, the, you know, having fun and looking outside the airplane and kind of forgetting for that 1 second is what God did. So that's something that we're trying to talk about here, is just always recognizing that it can happen to anyone at any time. Just always have to stay there. And you know, a lot of people talk about currency. We talk about currency and proficiency, and in this case, Nikk was both current and proficient and still fit him. So it's one of those things, you know, understanding our own vulnerability is what could potentially save us.
Absolutely.
So can I ask a question for you, Nikk? I know that was really well told. Take it back a little bit in slow motion for us. You mentioned that you got your entry to skidding turn. Was there a distraction that got you to that point? When did you recognize that that was happening? And, if you were to reel that back, what might you have done a little different to avoid that skidding turn?
Yes, my eyes were out of the cockpit from the moment I was looking down where I wanted to land and I saw Trent's plane next to me. He was on my left. And from that moment on, I was already looking out and, you know, the saying is where your head goes, your body goes. So I just started walking on that left rudder, didn't realize it. And by the time I realized it, I had already bled off a vast amount of air speed. I just didn't see it coming.
Do you remember whether there were winds causing a drift?
It was no, it was a day calm.
So it was a
beautiful day.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, I only saw a portion of what happened, but it definitely seemed like he might have been rushing his pattern, pulling in a little tighter, which we often do, but this one was a little more rushed than normal, and then I think maybe that would have led to somewhat of an accelerated stall, but he definitely was pulling it in tight and looking back, so I could see right where it happened.
Yeah, another thing is I had flattened rock top for more of a climb rock because I wasn't going on any trips. So I had done that 2 days before, and I hadn't flown plane in that configuration in over 100 hours. So I had a set of crews, I was just going back and forth places. And coming in with a little less energy and not realizing what was happening, and I came into it as if I was coming into it at 105, 110 miles an hour, when realistically I was coming into it about 85 to 90. So I had a lot less headroom to before I hit my stall. And especially coming into a hard bank, I was about a 30 degree bank initially, 30, 35 degrees or so. It was a little steep, and then you get the accelerator stall. It's the one that gets you.
So did you see any reaction to your controls you described and that continued to rotate?
No, I felt nothing through the controls. The wings snapped down, and it was really hard to, everything went so quick.
Yeah, just fundamentally didn't have the altitude for it to take effect.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, had I had another 100 feet below me, I probably wouldn't be here right now. I'd be walking still on mine. So it's very surreal. Yeah, I just want to be out here telling everybody what happened, so hopefully it'll make everybody change a little bit.
Could you talk a little bit more about what you did? It sounds like you did a great job of getting acquainted with your airplane and its performance. What else did you do in interphase one? Because we're working here at EAA to provide a flight test manual for folks, and there's 19 flight cards that people can go through and learn all of the details of performance and performance limitations and so forth. Sounds like you did a lot of that kind of thing.
Yeah, I tried to do as much of that. I was, you know, I wanted to go fly the plane. I just love being out there, and sometimes they are to get away from you. You need to accomplish what you want to do that day. What I started with is just flew around the airport, went up to a couple thousand feet above ground level, and started stalling it, feeling what it was going to do. I got all my performance data. I knew when it was going to stall at every flap setting. I knew what it was going to do at different altitudes, different density altitudes. I was flying, you know, some days it was 6,000 foot VA, and other days I got to 10,000. So I was all over, I knew what it was going to do. But And actually, for a week prior to that, or 3 weeks prior to that, I had spun the plane for the first time. And I think it would have been a different outcome had I not got up there and actually been proficient at spinning the plane and recovering. I think that muscle memory would have been there, because it's still a new plane to me. I have 150 hours in it. You know, you're not really yoke anymore, it's a stick, so it's a little different feel. And I think that helped save me, so I really put a good emphasis on spin training. I really think it's, and now I've said recovery, I think it's very important. And I always try to do it. I accelerate, stall the plane, I try to do everything to upset so I knew what it was going to do if I put it in that position.
So in looking back at that particular incident, then how would you approach it differently? Did you feel like there were allusions to the ground motion and the height of your pattern, or did you blow the pattern differently?
Absolutely. I would have, I did come nose up about 25 degrees, and you know, there's no reason to climb like that when you're out in a wide open desert and there's nothing, no mountains with, you know, 5 miles. So it was kind of an accumulation of small mess ups that led me to a very big mistake. And I think that's really what gets everybody in this position, is you don't think of the small mistakes and their consequences, and they just add up and everything tumbles until it's too late.
Yeah, the chain of events, just break one link and pull that
link. Exactly.
Again, thank you for sharing your story. It's really courageous and it's very valuable for us. I guess we ought to give a chance for the audience to ask some questions directly.
Actually, I think, Trent, we were going to talk a little bit about social media.
Yeah, really quickly. Part of why I'm here is to talk about what I do, which is, for those of you that haven't seen my videos, I run a YouTube channel, flying a Kitfox and going out and landing on mountaintops, going on adventures with my friends, and put a lot of time and energy into those. And since I've been doing them, I've met a lot of people that are looking to do the same, to film their adventures and spend more time documenting and sharing those with their friends. And I think it's very important that we talk about, with the added tasks of filming, flying, and documenting things for whether it's YouTube or any other social media platform, that you end up with a lot more tasks at hand. And it's something that, again, we can get caught in the moment and say, this is great, you know, I'm getting awesome footage, I'm having a blast, and then you start thinking about your cameras, checking if they're rolling, and before you know it, your head's outside the cockpit and you're not paying attention. So task saturation is something that we all need to be very aware of when we're doing any sort of video stuff. From a filmmaking standpoint, a vlog or a video log, what I do on YouTube, it ends up with having one person who is effectively being the director, the producer, the cameraman, the actor who's on screen, and then I'm also trying to be a pilot. That's a lot of hats to wear. So it's something to be super diligent and aware of, that anytime you pull out your phone to take a photo, even if it's just a single thing, just recognize ahead of time that you're lowering your awareness as far as the flying standpoint. And, you know, I always make sure that anywhere I'm going and any of the flying I'm doing is something that should be second nature. I'm not going out and trying something new on camera because it's just too much pressure. You know, Kodak courage is a real thing. I used to shoot ski videos and you would be blown away. You pull out a camera and the dumb stuff people do on their skis just to try to be famous. So it translates into the flying in the same way. So it's something that I just want to make sure everyone understands, that I'm super diligent of, and I really, really hope that everyone is as well.
What is
okay, questions from the audience. I'm sure we got a ton of them.
We got a mic here.
Yeah, we'll pass the mic.
Great story. What kind of small warning system do you have in your airplane?
So I didn't have any small warning in mine. I had a pre-built wing from Trent, so I didn't end up getting the time to craft the AOA. You know, it's going to do that my Martin system was capable of, so I was running without a stall warning. I was relying on field aircraft. And the Kitfox is beautiful in that sense, where it really talks to you. It lets you know when you're starting to get it into its developing stages of stall. It really lets you know. So issue before. I knew where its limits was. And you can feel it, so.
Yeah, in the lake bed we're at is about 4,000 feet, so I think density altitude that there's probably 5,500, but it's pretty much the normal altitude we're flying at, so I don't know if that was a huge factor, but it's something that would have been a factor if he was used to sea level, because that if he had done what he did at sea level, he might have been able to pull out of it down there. There just wasn't enough. Here.
What's the second one that's after being in an accident like that? Do you have to go to the treatment center to get your back to your early? There's a barrier that you have to get your back?
Mentally, yes. It's been really tough to sit here for the last 9 months not being able to go rectify what I did wrong and make good of the situation. So it's been a lot of me in my own head thinking, you know, what could I have done better? How can I avoid this at all costs in the future? And I'm lucky enough to get a chance to fly again, so I can do that.
I have a comment, then I'd like to ask a question. And my comment is doing a skid to the brake maneuver is eye-opening. If anybody hasn't done it and you fly, I highly advise you. You're a little scared of it, you love the instructor. I find Interstate Cadet with the most stable old airplanes out there, and I'm telling you, it was eye-opening, really eye-opening. So my question to you is, did you by any chance do any, go out and do any, skidding turns, yeah.
I did. I tried to accelerate stall planes as much as I possibly could in a skid and a slip, and also coordinated, and I knew what it was going to do, and actually, about a week prior, you were there, you know, I went up and showed Trent the spin, because I don't think you've ever done in your aircraft either. So, I went up there and I showed him what I was going to do, and I came into a little accelerated into a skid, and almost felt like it did the same thing when the accident happened. So the NTSB conducts their investigation on the aircraft, and I believe it's 14 days to accept a minor check ride. All right. Yes, yes, I have a question on here. And they tried to extend it to 6 months, and within that time, I wasn't healthy enough to fly in and take my recheck. So what I have to do is I voluntarily surrender my pilot's license. I won't have any black marks on my record for this one. But you know, I just had a very lucky situation as well.
Yeah, so the FAA, anytime there's a loss of control scenario, it's gonna require that you take a 709 check, which is basically another check ride to make sure that you're proficient in an aircraft. And since he was unable to take that 709 check ride, he basically surrendered his license for the meantime. That way he can go back once he's able to fly again and take that check ride.
Yeah, it was either voluntary surrender or they would suspend it, which I mean, it would be a much more process to get it done.
And sorry you went through what you did. I've got a question for you. Walk me through the speeds again as you were coming in. What you can remember of your speed as you entered, you saw trends, as you started to enter, and you realized the skid.
I wasn't looking at my airspeed at all. That was my mistake. So I didn't know where I entered. I felt like it was around 85 mile an hour mark, but that's just a feel, and that's judging off what I knew the plane has. And obviously, it was way too slow for the amount that I pulled the aircraft up and put it into a loaded turn.
Hey, Nick.
Hey,
guys. How's it going? you talked about complacency. You said you had 150 hours in your plane, and you know a lot of accidents happen with pilots when they start hitting. You know, not when they're brand new pilots, but when they start hitting that 300-500 hour mark, and they feel like they got it. You know, a lot of home builders, when they start flying their plane, they're kind of scared of it, they don't push it. When you say you got complacent, how do you recommend other pilots check themselves with that complacency and how they don't put themselves in that position?
Well, I think my issue for me was, my complacency was, I was, in my own mind, I was saying, I have no means to plan, and I know it very well, I think I know what it's going to do when it's going to do it, and that's what led me up to getting away from the anxiety. And the thing I'm going to take away from this is, no matter what, how proficient I feel on an aircraft from here on out, I'm never proficient enough. You can always learn. The day you stop learning aviation, the day you die.
Another thing too, when you're talking about, it's not the super low hour pilots that are the most dangerous. I've always been told, this guy Justin over here is always telling me, it's the 200 hour pilots. I think every time I hit a different hour mark, he's like, you're the most dangerous pilot, you're the most dangerous pilot. So I've always had in my head saying, statistically, I'm at the highest risk. And I think we all just mentally put that in our head. Stop thinking that you're high risk. Say that I'm in that zone that puts me at the most risk. And obviously, with the type of operation you're doing, slow and low, you don't have as much room to correct things. You always have to keep that in mind that, you know, I don't have room for errors, and I am at the highest risk. And if you have that mentality going into it, it's the same with the takeoff. Every time you advance your draw, you say, my engine is going to quit. And then, you know, when it doesn't, it's great, but if you're planning for it, you're ready for it. So keeping that kind of in your head and saying, I'm vulnerable, I am the one, I'm the dangerous one, then you'll keep it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how many hours or how much experience you have, you're always vulnerable. Gravity's always working against this.
Again, thank you for sharing your story. Do you think there's anything in particular about your aircraft type or configuration that might have contributed?
I don't think that there was anything with that. It was a neat thing. I drew the limits of the aircraft and I pushed it. I went a little too far on that one.
Yeah, it wasn't like there was any odd tendency that they didn't. It seemed more of one of those put himself in the wrong place. The attitude was that
good. Hey guys, as a new student pilot, thanks so much for inspiring us to become pilots. My question is, in your transition from a newbie pilot to still flying, can you just share a little bit about the background and how you did that transition and what someone's path might look like?
Is that from your turn? Okay, well, I started off just airport to airport, and I really didn't hit even a gravel road until about 150 hours of total flight time. And that was with my instructor, my brother, in 172. That was kind of my first taste in it. And he explained, you know, you go do a little pass. You want to assess where you're going to plant the plane. You want to know where you're going to put the plane. And you want to have a plane marked out in mind and where you want to land. And then we go into the mentality of it. It's the risk versus reward. Is it worth going where you're going? You know, a big dry lake bed, I'd be more apt to go my first landing there, and that's what I did. Then go try, you know, a 10-foot wide dirt road with fences on either side. And, you know, those are some of the places that we go land. And those are the ones we avoid and we're trying to avoid.
Yeah, you know, it's all baby steps. We like to say anyone can really go out and be a backcountry pilot, but it all starts with small steps. For me, I got my Kitfox when I think I had 60 hours total time and zero tail wheel time when I bought it. So at first it was learning how to control the aircraft, but, you know, in part of that, figuring it out, knowing the mark on the runway, it all starts on the runway. Any school environment, just pick a place on the runway, figure out where you're going to hit, and get to where you can hit your mark every time. And then once you're very comfortable in aircraft, you can start venturing off into the lighter stuff. And like I said, baby step. I think Quinn was the guy that took me out and showed me around. We did lake bed circuits, and then you work your way into dirt roads like
did laps for 4 hours one day around the lake bed, just dragging one tire, the other tire, and landing, just learning our aircraft, and put it right to the brink of the stall, 4 feet above the ground, as slow flight as you can go. And that was just to gain proficiency in the aircraft, and I think it was great for you, because you hadn't done that in a while. You know, Kevin Quinn put it great yesterday in the air forum. If you're not stalling your airplane every time you're flying, you're doing it wrong. You need to be out there and know your aircraft every day. If that's the condition you're going to fly, it's the back.
Hey guys, just to expand on what you were just talking about there, Nikk, you said you had 150 hours, something like that, on the airplane. You were getting to know it. What was your background prior to flying your Kitfox ability, your Kitfox? What kind of experience did you have? And can you guys both kind of talk to what you are now in the logbook, so to speak?
Yeah, absolutely. I currently have 1,300 hours. About 900 hours of that time is in a Cherokee 140, so a very underpowered, especially for our altitude. And it really gave you that pitch power, and you got to know exactly what's going on. And it also really gave you a good sense of when not to fly. And you have to, another thing that you know, this is it a good day to fly? But most of my time is in that plane. I had some time in the 7210, some piloting stuff. I had probably 20 hours in the log in Trent's plane, sonar, cruise around with him. So I had a good feel of what the airplane was going to feel like in the beginning. And I also went to one of our Kitfox instructors locally in Reno, and I flew about 7 hours with him prior to taking my test flight, because I didn't want to go up in my plane the first day I fly by ground looping it. That's just not fun. And ratings, I'm commercial instrument with a CFI. And my mobile engine I got about a month before the accident. Be pretty proud of that.
And as far as me, I'm just a standard private pilot, most dangerous guy out there. I've got about 900 hours, 850 in a tailwheel in the back.
Charlie, how many hours do you
have? Somewhere around 12,000, a little bit less. And 95 different types of airplanes, and a thing that flies in space.
Quiet, she didn't know what to expect. And I briefed her on everything,
didn't brief her on the checklist before. And when we got home, my wife asked her, so how'd you like it? She said, well, I thought it was great, but he kept reading that book, and I thought, doesn't he know how to fly this thing?
Pete, I think we've got time for maybe one more, and then these gentlemen can wrap up. I know they're committed to other locations, so anybody, one more? Right here.
Maybe more for Trent. Some of these small general aviation aircraft, like myself, since I was 18 and recently got into powered paragliding, and then you realize that there is a whole social media aspect to it, and some sort of feedback on the people who are posting on social media, whether it's your self-imposed burden or by others. What about promoting safety as part of your social media? Do you feel that? Is it self-imposed, or is it a burden that you think you should take on? Because so many people think, oh, yeah, YouTube can do it, I can do it too.
Yeah, you know, that's the topic of discussion that I've had with a lot of other creators, I guess you call us. And it's a tough one, because we always talk about disclaimers. Should we have a disclaimer in front of our video that, you know, you shouldn't go out and do this? And, I keep looking back to, at the end of the day, the people that read and listen to disclaimers are not the ones that are going to go out and do it. You know, there was a show on MTV called Jackass that had the biggest disclaimer. Don't do this, you know, and then how many people went out and replicated it anyway. So we're always balancing the, do you dilute what you're doing and showing the fun side by having a safety talk, and will it be received properly? So that's something that I'm still, I guess, balancing and kind of fighting with, figuring out how to integrate it in a tasteful way that will be received by the right people.
All right, Elijah, Pete, we do have one young lady who would like to ask a quick question.
Okay. Just checking in on your well-being. I wonder where you are in the healing process. How much longer do you have to go? What's the hardest of those surgeries?
So today I had 12 surgeries. The last one was real minor, just doing some open wound death on my right leg. I'm hopefully going to be walking within the next month or so, and that's good. Always take longer, I don't know. And I don't know when I'll be flying again. I don't know how physical therapy is going to go. There's just so many variables at this point.
Where are you up healing?
What leg? Oh, my healing right now, my both legs are internally fixed. Everything's put together. There's a bone graft solidifying both legs right now, and everything's regrowing. So it's just a very long, drawn out process, because with the compound fracture, you have so much tissue torn away from the bone. Blood flow. So my body's been working on building new veins and everything you need. It's been trying to do it.
So you just want to get some closing thoughts?
Yes, thank you. First off, again, thanks for your courage and coming forward to share your story, because it will help all of us. We hear from the NTSB, loss of control is something that is the most common by far of the accidents. Drivers can lose our friends. And so because of that, many years ago, back about 2011, the NTSB wrote a report that the FAA took on. We were losing a tremendous number of folks due to loss of control. With Air EAA, we took on an initiative in collaboration with both the FAA and the NTSB to address loss of control. Last night, we had the Founders Innovation Prize fourth running, where we've engaged the creativity of our membership to try to think about things that be brought to bear in an inexpensive way to help all of us avoid loss of control. We're going to continue that competition. We're continuing to raise the awareness. We're promoting a lot of programs where folks can get exposed to the things that they need to avoid loss of control. And so what we've had is we've seen a nice trend where we're down since 2011 about 50% in the fatality rate, but one fatality is still too much. We're really thankful he's here to share that lesson, because if he wasn't, we'd be having a lot of questions that wouldn't be answered. He's here to answer them for us. So your courage in sharing that is incredibly important to us. I can't thank you enough for all of us.
We do have a big fact that you can look up.
accident. If you want to know more about loss of control, the NTSB has booths in the Federal Pavilion. It's Hangar D. And we're doing some presentations over there. And we also have safety alerts on loss of control and some other different categories of accidents. So you can come on over and talk with investigators about anything over there. And again, thanks to these three guys. We really appreciate your time today.